Oh, crap. All right. Whoops. Here we go. Sorry about that. I had muted from the end of the AMD keynote. Let's start that again. Welcome, everybody, to round two of streaming. Adam Patrick Murray here for PC World with Elena Yi on Zoom. Let's try that again.
Hello.
Hey, hello. And yeah, there we go. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, now we're fixed. Okay, sorry about that. It's late. It's a Monday night. It's a holiday. Yeah, it's late for us. We're just about to watch NVIDIA. We had watched AMD earlier. It was a good time. Now let's see what NVIDIA has from Computex. Once again, if you want to watch just the NVIDIA keynote without us talking, because we will be talking over this, there is a link in the description. Go watch that. But really, you're here to see us drink some more fine beverages and
yeah, watch. What'd you got this time? We had the ginger and lime before.
Yeah, so... Oh, okay, so they're just giving us a placeholder thing. Okay, so... It got pushed live, but they're going to give us their own countdown.
That's what they normally do. Oh, okay. They don't like a hard intro. They to have a little more polished.
So we
bring it in.
We got a little time before that starts. This is also from Ale Industries. It's the working porter. It's Imperial Porter with raspberry. So nice and dark. We got a little raspberry, flavor. So yeah, glad to crack this open from Ale Industries. And yeah, we got all the cool kids in the chat. David Richards, what's going on? John Dokick. Sous Vide, what's going on? How you doing?
Oh, hey.
Michael Boria Zero, all the cool kids are here. To watch the NVIDIA keynote. Once again, this is live in from Computex. The reason why it's so late for us in the U.S. is because it's supposedly over in Taiwan time. Even though it's digital, they're still doing it in Taiwan time. So glad to have everybody here hanging out. So we saw AMD. I'm still, man, my brain's still trying to wrap
processing.
Around. Yeah, still processing. And now we're going to get some NVIDIA news here. So. Yeah, we'll see. I think I'll wake up tomorrow morning with, once again, way more questions than answers that I'll have to get from Gordon. Sounds like the audio is okay now. We're back. I just want to double check that everybody can hear and see us.
They left comments on the scrolling.
Oh, yes. That it's weird. I'm not quite sure why they had chat off for AMD, but they're on for NVIDIA. I guess we'll see. Uh-huh. We do already know, or at least they've announced that this isn't Jensen. Jensen's not going to be keynoting or heading up the keynote. We have two other fine gentlemen from AMD who are going to be presenting. So
NVIDIA.
Oh, I'm sorry. NVIDIA.
It's late.
Right.
It's a holiday weekend. It's late.
I know. And John Dokick, you control NVIDIA all you want in this chat. These were all the cool kids are hanging out, so glad to have you here. Okay, sounds like audio is okay. And yeah, no kitchen. Well, I don't know. We'll see. Will one of the presenters give a little nod to a kitchen set? Maybe one of them will be from their garage. The other one will be from their washroom or laundry room. Like you get the whole NVIDIA family from different parts of the house.
It's just the same house, and they're just doing like a surreptitious tour through it.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure. I guess we will see. Somebody said earlier in Discord that it is pretty crazy. What is this world coming to where Gordon reviews a GPU and Brad is posting CPU news? I have no idea. Once again, this is that they were under NDA for all the AMD stuff, so we didn't get insight to what they were doing. So I didn't get a chance to be like, "Hey, Gordon, why are you reviewing a GPU?" Not quite sure. So
crazy world.
What a crazy world. But that's a great thing about Gordon and Brett is that they know a lot about a lot of stuff. Maybe they just wanted to switch it up. Who knows? We can ask them later. And David Richards, somebody can bring a container with spatulas in it. We'll see. Oh, actually, you know what? Now that I realize the last NVIDIA one... No. Hmm. The last NVIDIA one was Jensen, wasn't it? Keynote.
I can't remember.
Now I'm trying to remember. Yeah.
Wait, was it the one where they were in somebody's office? I'm so blanking on the executive's name. Dang it.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure. One thing I am interested to see is if they're going to give any updates to GeForce Now. I know that's kind of a running joke that that Brad likes to bring up GeForce Now, but I do still occasionally use it. I think streaming is an interesting thing to keep pushing forward, even though it's not perfect technology, but it's been out as of last year, and yeah, the pricing's still pretty solid, and the games they at least I get an email every week, you know, talking about new games they've added, and some have gone. So I'm curious to see if they touch on GeForce Now at all, or the streaming future that Gordon's so scared about. Lupe, how many beers? Well, this is my first beer, and then I had a seltzer earlier, so one per keynote is all I'm gonna do right now. Oh wow, okay. Dave Richards pointed out, Elena, I didn't realize your background change is
thanks for catching.
Yeah,
it.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Good job, David. And Matthew Lang, birthday boy Matthew Lang is here. What's going on? Yeah.
Happy birthday.
Yeah, glad you're not in bed and you're hanging out. Oh, it's 1 a.m. where they are.
Oh, you're East Coast. Oh, wow. That's dedication.
I
think sleep's more important than the news, to be honest.
Brad's sleeping.
Brad is sleeping.
He probably already pre-wrote what he had. Who knows if he got clued into any of it early. So I guess we'll see when the time comes. Once again, as people are coming in, we will be watching the stream. And if you want to see it without our commentary, you can go to the link in the description, because they also have a chat over there that you can spam too. So try not to spam our chat.
It's it's intense.
And Steelskin said it's 7 a.m. Haven't watched the AMD keynote yet. Yeah, it was kind of a doozy. So. Yeah.
It was. Yeah, you definitely want to catch that.
Yeah, yeah. We'll see. We'll see what this one brings to the table. I think a lot of people will have the sentiment of. Excuse me. Why are they even introducing new parts if that's what they're gonna announce is new cards if nobody can get them, you know, technology still needs to go forward. Stuff will continue to be built, and I bet if it's anything like the stuff that they've been talking about recently, they'll introduce more features of how to combat scalpers and miners. I don't know.
Well, the focus on this is supposed to be AI. So
true. Maybe the AI algorithms will see if your GPU is mining.
I also wonder if that means we're going to see any changes or improvements to
DLSS.
Yeah, sorry, I was just looking at this description on their actual thing, and it's very scant. But if I remember right, the press release for this mentioned like AI type stuff. So yeah, wonder if they're going to mention any improvements to the whole ray tracing and DLSS.
Yeah, maybe
type features.
Also, Flash Photo, I would love to see a new Nintendo Switch Pro, but that, like with AMD, it's not going to happen here. That's a Nintendo press conference waiting to happen.
It's true.
If it does
happen. Would it be hilarious if they were like, yeah, so we're doing a Switch Pro, and it's actually going to be, like, cloud-assisted so that it looks better.
Well, there's actually a couple cloud games on the Switch now. I got Control and Hitman 3. They call it the cloud version. I can't remember what they're using on the back end. It's a company that I haven't used before for their cloud streaming service. But Yeah. I mean, maybe they'll talk about a new mobile processor, a new Tegra upgrade. And it's like, okay, well, you know, if there's a new Tegra upgrade, then obviously it'll have something to do with it.
Just to set expectations, this will cover more than just the consumer gaming side of things. So there's going to be part of it where they're going to be talking about data center and other stuff that it's not going to be as interesting to, you know, people who really just want gaming related news. So just FYI.
Yeah, we're kind of lucky because AMD, I mean, they did talk about Epic a little bit earlier. But yeah, like Elena said, not only it's the venue, but it's also the people who were talking about stuff. So if there's anything to glean from this, it's going to be different than a Jensen keynote. And it's different than a CES. Maybe we'll see what's a car company that would come out and say, hey, you know what, we have a Tegra. Ford has Ford. A new Tegra processor. They built a switch in the new Fords to combat the Tesla.
I mean, like, that's AMD. A quintessential American brand, right? So like, why not just have more America with your America?
That would be funny. And magical flying fox, you know, we can't answer those questions. You're just throwing these hypotheticals out there and we have no idea. We don't even know if that's what they're going to talk about. So, and Ruru too, I didn't know that 3090s got stolen from a factory. That's news to me. Yeah, we'll see how it goes. Either way, I do know, I think they said ahead of time it's only going to be a 30-minute presentation. So, and then like we did with AMD, Elaine and I will hang out a little bit afterward to kind of recap some of the
chat a
the
bit.
Yeah, the announcements. If it is hardware related,
thank you for joining us at Computex 2020.
Another little introduction from
insights into the state of our shared
there we go.
This week through our online
over.
Exhibition by the world's most important tech companies, keynotes from industry leaders, our series of forums, and online.
Is he still sitting at that table?
He's standing today to introduce our next keynote from NVIDIA. Over nearly three decades, the company has repeatedly transformed itself, and in doing so, transformed our entire industry.
Gordon's not here. Brad's not here. We're just hanging. Elena and I are hanging out.
It's a half full nerd.
Yeah, we were just gonna watch these live streams anyway, so we thought, why not live stream the live stream and have all you fine folks in the chat hang out with us. So,
senior Vice President
of NVIDIA. Oh, and I forgot to put it up on Discord.
Has been at the center of the PC gaming industry for many years. Since 1999, generations of GeForce cards have brought innovations and excitement to hundreds of millions of gamers in Taiwan, Asia, and around the world. We also will hear from
Manuel Das,
who is the head of enterprise computing at NVIDIA. He has a long history driving cloud-scale computing and plays a central role in the company's many breakthroughs in this field. So please join me in welcoming
In Decoy, yeah, no problem. Go watch their stream. Come back for our little post-show thing. It'll always be a fun time. So, yeah, once again, if you don't want our commentary during the stream, there's a link in the description to go watch NVIDIA's keynote. Because
we will probably be commenting and talking.
Oh, Flight Sim. All right. Starting off with some games.
Oh, I'm behind you by like a second.
We miss Taiwan and wish we could be there in person for Computex. So we created Taipei City in Microsoft Flight Sim and flew in virtually on a GeForce RTX 3080.
See, it sounds like they flew in on a GPU, but that looks like an airplane to me.
Too late for your puns, Adam.
Thousands of mods have been created for Flight Sim, and they've been downloaded over 10 million times. This mod will be available just after the keynote.
Wait, it's a mod? What was the mod? That Taipei was in the game? I don't know.
Welcome to Computex 2021. It's always great to talk directly to our partners, and this year we have a lot to talk about. I'm going to kick it off with gaming, and then I'll hand it to Manavir Das to talk about AI and our enterprise platforms. So let's get started.
They I don't think they compressed anything. I think they just like lessened the initial install.
I'm okay with that. I mean,
it's a huge game.
Forever to download that, especially because the Xbox app interface is like, I think, caps its bandwidth compared to when I download through Steam.
Every person born this year will be a gamer. 140 million of them. In fact, Gen Z prefers video gaming as their favorite entertainment activity over just about anything. In Taiwan, two-thirds of the population plays video games. So it's no surprise that gaming has transformed into one of the largest and fastest-growing forms of entertainment, and it is here to stay. Gaming revenue grew to $180 billion, bigger than cinema, music, and streaming video combined. We added 60 million PC gamers to our ranks, and over 10,000 games were published for them to enjoy. In April, the number of concurrent gamers on Steam was at an all-time high of 27 million, 1.5 times that of 2019. Like any sport, people love to watch others play. 100 billion hours of gaming content was viewed on YouTube, and more than 430 million people tuned into esports competitions. And it doesn't stop there. Minecraft's open world is estimated to have grown to 4 billion square kilometers, or 8 times the surface of the planet. Valve just announced that the 2021 Dota Championship will feature a $40 million prize pool. Roblox had 42 million daily active users in the first quarter, up 80% year over year. And it's not just about playing. There are 45 million professional and freelance creators fueling an explosion in digital content, 30 million broadcasters, and 75 million higher ed STEM students, all relying on the latest technology to improve their productivity and quality of work. Over the past 20 years, we have built GeForce into the number one gaming platform. With 1.5 billion GPUs shipped, GeForce has fueled the growth of PC gaming, and we continue to delight our customers with new ways to game and create. Our scale and pace of innovation was only possible by partnering with the best companies in the world. Together, we have transformed PC gaming. 10 years ago, we introduced Optimus, dramatically extending battery life in gaming laptops. All told, Optimus has saved over 5.8 billion kilowatt hours of energy, enough to power over 500,000 homes for a year. Max-Q changed the way laptops were built. The performance only available in big, heavy gaming machines was engineered into thin and light laptops. Max-Q has shed over 8 million pounds from gaming laptops sold. G-Sync introduced stutter-free gaming. With over 20 trillion buttery smooth pixels now shipped, once you game with G-Sync, there is no turning back. Last year, we introduced NVIDIA Reflex, which changed the game for esports competitors. In Call of Duty Warzone alone, Reflex gamers have over 50 million wins. Finally, NVIDIA Studio is our platform for creators, engineered for the needs of creative professionals.
NVIDIA Studio, that's what I was trying to think
earlier. Our laptops have accelerated over 25 billion hours of content creation. Thanks to all of our partners who are just as excited as we are about reinventing this market and are joining us in the next major leap forward. RTX is a huge reset to computer graphics, a decade in development, RTX introduced the world to real-time ray tracing and AI for graphics. RTX is now available in a full range of desktops and laptops in every country, from every OEM, and even streaming from the cloud. With over 100 top games and apps available today, RTX is the new standard. For creators and broadcasters, RTX is accelerating the number one photography app, the number one video editing
Photoshop
app, and the number one broadcast app.
Mm-hmm.
For gamers,
Photoshop up front.
RTX is powering the number one Battle Royale, the number one RPG, and the number one best-selling game of all time. Last month, we added Outriders and Call of Duty Warzone to the list. And today, we have more exciting games to announce. Dying 1983 is the second game in the Dying franchise from the Chinese developer Netcom. It's a Japanese-inspired horror-themed puzzle game. Its stark and frightening world is brought to life with RTX ray tracing and DLSS. Let's take an exclusive look at Dying 1983 with RTX on.
Jintai.
I don't know anything about this series. Dying Reborn, Dying Island. I'm not getting subtitles for the Japanese.
I'm not either. Mm. I'm not sure if that's on purpose or not.
Okay, yeah. Just making sure I wasn't missing something on my end.
This game was just a little bit louder than the rest of the presentation.
Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege is one of the most popular esports games in the world, with over 70 million players worldwide. In March, Rainbow Six gamers gained the competitive edge of NVIDIA Reflex. Today, we are announcing that RTX gamers will get even more performance with the addition of DLSS. Let's take a look.
You know, Siege is still huge. I know people who are still actively playing that game. I never got into it, but it's still big. And Kim Repark, this is Computex, yes, not E3. But you want to kick off with games, huh? Oh, and we got a Nuta Lucian from Romania. Hey, what's going on?
Welcome. That's a pretty big jump in frames, man.
Right, and I mean, especially a competitive shooter like this, it's important.
New Zealand-based developer Rocketworks was founded by Dean Hall, best known as the creator of DayZ. Their highly anticipated new game, Icarus, is a stunning multiplayer survival game set on a savage alien planet. Today we are announcing that Icarus will come alive with RTX Ray Trace Global Illumination and DLSS when the initial chapter, First Cohort, launches this fall. Let's take a look at some exclusive new footage.
I'm glad they're showing games.
This does have a little bit of an E3 vibe to it. My stream quality is not really good, so I'm not getting personally that much. I'm not actually getting as much of a benefit in seeing these comparison shots. Like, I can see that it gets a little bit sharper, but it's kind of slightly fuzzy for me.
Red Dead Redemption 2 is one of the most critically acclaimed games of all time.
You're
with more than 275 perfect scores, 175 Game of the Year awards, and more than 37 million copies sold to date. We are happy to announce that Rockstar Games will be adding DLSS to Red Dead Redemption 2. Coming soon, every RTX gamer will see a free boost in performance. VR is taking off. VR game revenue is up 70% on Steam in 2020. The installed base of PC-compatible VR headsets is expected to exceed 30 million in the next 5 years. With almost twice the resolution of a desktop monitor and unforgiving FPS requirements, VR is very demanding on the GPU. And RTX is now coming to VR. No Man's Sky, the popular open-world space game, now features DLSS. VR gamers can soon play with ultra graphics at 90 frames per second.
I should go
Wrench,
back and try No Man's Sky
a mechanic
again.
Simulator where you repair and maintain race cars in VR, now features RTX ray tracing and DLSS. And the VR survival shooter, Into the Radius, adds DLSS to boost performance and keep you immersed in this dystopian world. 75% of GeForce gamers play esports. We invented NVIDIA Reflex for them. The difference between winning and losing is a matter of milliseconds. On average, Reflex reduces system latency by 20 milliseconds. It gets the PC out of the way so a gamer's real skill can come to play. And gamers love it. More than 90% of them compete with Reflex on. Today, we are announcing even more NVIDIA Reflex games. Gaijin's War Thunder, the most popular air, land, and sea battle arena with over 40 million gamers. Naraka: Bladepoint, the highly anticipated battle royale slasher from 24 Entertainment. In the last closed beta, it broke into Steam's top 5 games played. Tencent Games' Crossfire HD is a remastered version of the original with over 560 million gamers in China. And Escape from Tarkov, the intense survival shooter from Battlestate Games, is one of the top 10 most played competitive shooters. Coming soon, 12 of the top 15 competitive shooters will feature NVIDIA Reflex. Let's take a look at Reflex in Escape from Tarkov.
Yeah, I've heard of this game before, Escape from Tarkov, but I don't really know anything about it.
Really?
Yeah.
I do wonder, though, like, am I just too old that I don't really know that many people who care about this kind of sort of e-sport angle on
reducing
features,
system
you know
latency
what I mean?
Starts by measuring it from end to end. This requires an ecosystem
old.
Of partners. Last year, we introduced the Reflex Latency Analyzer, measurement
you.
Tool built directly into gaming monitors. Today, we are adding Lenovo, ViewSonic, and EVGA. 13 partners are offering a total of 15 monitors and 21 compatible mice. Now, more gamers can simply plug a mouse into their monitor and accurately measure end-to-end latency from click to photon.
Oh, I actually didn't know you
Almost
could do that.
Almost 10 years ago, we introduced our Kepler architecture and created a new class of laptops for gamers.
That's a neat trick.
While the market reception was great, these laptops were large, bulky, and had limited battery life, more transportable than portable. In 2016, we introduced the Pascal architecture and Max-Q technology, a full system design approach to bringing high performance to thin and light laptops.
Yeah, chat.
Performance increased by over 4x, and for the first time, high-performance gaming laptops were less than 20 millimeters thick.
Kind of like
this year, we launched
Ampere,
our second generation RTX.
Throughout their lifetime.
It featured our third generation Max-Q and delivered twice the performance of Pascal. But the real magic is DLSS. Gamers have taken notice, and GeForce laptops are the fastest growing gaming platform. Laptops are a marvel of engineering. No effort is spared to deliver the highest performance in a thin and light device. In laptop design, system power determines everything, including performance, battery life, thinness, and acoustics. What if you could get a massive boost in gaming performance without expending any more power? Let's say you are playing Control at 47 frames per second. At 1440p, the GPU is rendering almost 4 million pixels and drawing 80 watts of power. NVIDIA DLSS uses AI-powered tensor cores to boost frame rates. With DLSS, the GPU only needs to render a fraction of the pixels and then uses AI to complete the frame. The result is an image just as beautiful as native 1440p. And you get 1.5 to 2 times the performance at the same power. Alienware was one of our earliest partners, designing high-performance GeForce PCs for gamers. For the past 2 years, it is interesting who is it Packard Geek
says that
today
they
we're announcing the
reminds us that they're using Max-Q tech nomenclature here in the laptop. Presentation, but they don't powered necessarily anymore on the actual yes. selling of the hardware.
That's a very good point. Optimus, I was a little surprised by that.
A 1440p display. It's the world's most powerful sub 16 millimeter 15 inch gaming laptop. Tune into the Alienware update event on June 1st to learn more. This year brought a record launch for RTX laptops, with over 140 models from every OEM. Starting at $799 and featuring Max-Q, there is now an RTX laptop for every gamer. We developed NVIDIA Studio to address the growing needs of 3D designers, video editors, and photographers. These are specially configured systems, optimized and tested for creator workflows, and supported with a monthly cadence of studio drivers. Today, we are announcing new studio laptops from HP and Acer. The 14-inch HP Envy brings the capabilities of RTX to an ultra-portable laptop, great for students and creators on the go. The new Acer Concept D offers a variety of traditional clamshell options and an easel sketchboard design to give creators even more flexibility.
I kind of dig that concept.
Gaming has been an inspiration
design.
To digital creators.
Yeah, I've tried it out. It's pretty cool.
Machinima, an art form started in the 90s.
Willis actually has a Concept D, but not the easel one.
Assets, visual effects, and character animation to create short, humorous clips or full-length movies. For these artists, we created Omniverse Machinima, making it easy to produce cinematic animated stories with advanced real-time ray tracing and AI. Users import their own game assets or draw from our growing library. They can then apply advanced physics effects like destruction or fire with NVIDIA's Blast and Flow. Animate movements using only a webcam with Wrench's AI Pose, and use simple audio tracks to animate character faces with audio to face. The final scenes are rendered in the Omniverse RTX renderer. Machinima was just released in beta. Let me show you how you can create your own masterpiece.
Oh, it's so loud. Sorry, stream. I'm trying to ride the fader here. Woo. It's too late for this loudness.
I'm glad I'm getting like a heads up from you.
Yeah, pull it back.
I'm able to switch. I gotta admit though, I mean, I don't know what's coming obviously still, but after AMD's announcement about we're gonna support older GeForce cards, I'm a little like, come on, I'm waiting to be equally razzled and dabbled here.
Look at me! I'm in the Omniverse!
Is this the kind of stuff that would help
hey,
YouTubers?
Look at that.
I see you in my kitchen!
Oh, I guess it would be like...
Okay, that's actually kind of funny. How to bake your first GPU.
We finally got the kitchen that everyone
RTX has been a huge success. And today we are announcing a new addition to the family. The GeForce RTX 3080 Ti is our new flagship gaming GPU. Based on Ampere, with second-generation RT cores and third-generation Tensor cores, Ampere is our greatest generational leap ever.
Oh, and here comes something loud again. Well, there we go. Yeah, 3080 Ti.
That is the worst-kept secret in the last few weeks, I feel like. I assume that's supposed to be titanium we're watching.
I guess. It's pretty. And yes, NVIDIA's, I believe NVIDIA's official pronunciation of that is Ti. Yes.
It's titanium.
It's everybody else says Ti.
And Timothy Baldridge. You're right, like we do have to see if AMD actually delivers on what they promised. But I mean, coming out there like that, I mean, that's a pretty big statement to make.
The 80 Ti class of GPUs represents the best of our gaming lineup.
They have
the GTX 1080 Ti released in 2017 could tackle all the games of its time. But this well-loved GPU simply can't keep up with the demands of modern games. The RTX 2080 Ti was introduced as the only way to play in 4K with RTX on. But the production value of games continues to march forward.
I know, I was
new
just thinking that too.
Titles like Cyberpunk 2077 and Watch Dogs Legion have elevated realism, demanding even more of the GPU. The RTX 3080 Ti is 1.5 times faster than its predecessor and tears through the latest games with all the settings cranked up. The RTX 3080 Ti is a powerful GPU with 34 shader teraflops,
Chat's really not liking
67 RT teraflops, and 273 tensor teraflops. It comes equipped with 12 gigabytes of ultra-fast G6X memory and a 384-bit memory interface. Availability will begin on June 3rd, starting at $1,199. To show you what this beast can do, we have a special announcement. Doom is a storied franchise known by a generation of gamers for pushing the boundaries of speed, power, and visual effects. Doom Eternal, the latest in the series, takes this even further. Based on the id Tech 7 engine, it's blistering fast and beautiful. Today we're announcing Doom Eternal is adopting RTX ray tracing and DLSS. Here is a first look at Doom Eternal with ray tracing at 4K running on a 3080 Ti.
I mean, I tried again. It's just... I just like Doom 2016 much better. But, yeah. I mean, DLSS, though, that's... If you can allow DLSS without ray tracing, which usually is the case, like... That'll help that game run super smooth. It's beautiful. Yeah, 1200. 1200 MSRP. I wish Doom Eternal had a benchmarking mode.
Yeah.
As I get older, I really appreciate more games that have benchmarking modes in them. Also, this job too.
And that's not all. The RTX 3070 quickly became our most popular Ampere GPU. Now we're adding a tie to this class of GeForce, with more cores and super fast G6X memory. Today we're announcing the all-new RTX 3070 Ti. It's 1.5 times faster than a 2070 Super, and availability will begin on June 10th, starting at $599. Thanks everyone for your time. Before I hand it off to Manavir, let me summarize. Gaming is transforming entertainment, and RTX is changing everything. Not just for gamers, but for 150 million creators, broadcasters, and students. With over 100 of the top games and creative apps accelerated, RTX is the new standard. GeForce laptops are the fastest growing gaming platform. Now fueled top to bottom by RTX, third generation Max-Q, and the performance boosting magic of DLSS. And Studio, specially designed for creators, extends their reach beyond gaming. Finally, the RTX desktop family just got better with our new flagship gaming GPU, the GeForce RTX 3080 Ti and the GeForce RTX 3070 Ti. Every person born today is a gamer. We have an amazing future ahead, and we look forward to building it with all of you. And here to tell you how we're putting AI into the hands of every company is Manavir Das.
Every person today head of is enterprise born a gamer. Computing. Everyone. That was just a funny line.
We still got a little bit more.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us today.
This is going to be all data center, I think, stuff.
NVIDIA began with gaming. But today, we are also the driver of the most powerful technology force of our time, artificial intelligence. Let's take a look at just some of the ways in which AI, powered by NVIDIA, is improving our world.
Oh, sorry, Al Bundy. Gordon was born before nowadays, so he's not a gamer. It just, yeah, he's too old.
Oh boy, chat is continue to it just explode.
I am a creator.
Not ours. The obviously the.
Blending art and technology. To immerse our senses.
Nikki, no problem. Glad you could be here to join us.
Helping us take the next step. And see what's possible.
That looks like a fake device.
I mean, it's pretty cool, though.
I am a pioneer.
Thanks for stopping by, Magical Flying Fox. Answers.
And pushing the edge to the outer limits. Defending our oceans.
Isn't that redundant? The edge is the outer limit.
Oh.
Well, and the magnificent creatures that call them home.
You can still walk to an edge.
But by definition, the edge is the actual end of the outer limit.
I am a protector.
I can't. I'm an editor. I can't turn this off.
Breathe easier.
The RTX eye cannon.
And watching over it for generations to come. I am the storyteller, giving emotion to words and bringing them to life. I am even the composer of the music.
Interesting. There's less uncanny valley in that than I would expect.
I am AI, brought to life by NVIDIA, deep learning, and brilliant minds everywhere.
Yes, Messy Lang, a VTuber, was just born.
And that was just a hint of what AI can do. Taiwan has always been a very special place for NVIDIA. From system builders and solution providers to universities and the government, all have partnered with us. On behalf of Jensen and NVIDIA, thank you to all of our many friends in Taiwan who have worked alongside us to enable these amazing AI breakthroughs. Together, we have laid the foundation for a new computing model based on AI, software that writes software. This foundation includes GPUs deployed in the cloud and in data centers, AI software and SDKs tailored to the world's largest industries, and an ecosystem of startups and developers. Now it's time to build the house on top of this foundation. It is time to democratize AI by bringing its transformative power to every company and its customers. There are three fundamental shifts that will bring AI to every company. The first shift is that every application used by any company will be infused with AI. AI is essentially a two-step process. First, a rich set of existing data and known outcomes from that data are used to train a model. Then, the model is applied to fresh data to make fresh judgments. The model is effectively a piece of software that can be embedded into any application. As the application runs, it queries the model to make judgments, giving it intelligence. As new data becomes available, the model is retrained and improved, automatically making the application better without human developers having to create a new version. A great example of this infusion of AI is in Microsoft Office, the world's most popular productivity application. Microsoft is adding smart experiences such as smart grammar correction, Q&A, and text prediction to Office.
I hear a kitty. I'll be right back.
With NVIDIA GPUs, Microsoft was able to improve responsiveness to less than 1/5 of a second, enabling real-time grammar correction, and at 1/3 the cost of the same work on CPUs. Going forward, every application will have to be built in this way or be left behind. Now, this is not the first time we've seen this kind of shift. For example, consider the introduction of the graphical user interface, the GUI. Once the transformative value of GUI became evident, every command line application had to adopt GUI or be left behind. In the same way, every application will need to be infused with AI. And all of these applications will need the most performant, power-efficient, and cost-effective systems to run on, regardless of form factor or location, from edge to cloud. Every system will need a GPU. The second shift is that every data center used by any company will be infused with AI. Computing is increasingly being driven by large amounts of data. Neither the data nor the computation done on it can fit on one server. Therefore, the flow of data through the network becomes crucial to both the capability and the security of the data center. A new kind of hardware is needed that sits on the data path and intelligently optimizes, inspects, and protects the data, and protects the applications from one another. This new hardware is the data processing unit, or DPU. Every server will need a DPU. The third shift is that the life cycle of every product
my CPU is a noted processor
will be optimized computer. By AI. Consider the very common and old-fashioned example
this is
of
definitely
soap.
Not geared towards us.
Yes.
No.
So, going forward, a soap company will design and tailor its soap product portfolio by analyzing rich data.
I mean,
on the
it is interesting to think how
base.
Prevalent AI is.
The soap manufacturing process will be automated and optimized with AI. Customers who use soap, pretty much the entire population of the world, will be engaged socially and sold to online. Smart soap dispensers will track usage and automatically order refills. And all the data from the customer experience will be fed back to guide the design and supply chain of the soap. This soap company and every other company will need a new form of IT and IT infrastructure
like
to operate the AI-optimized lifecycle of its product.
The soap?
These are
soap.
Fundamental shifts that will require massive amounts of accelerated
computing.
In
like pragmatic terms.
Now AI let's soap. Talk about how you can build on the technology foundation of NVIDIA to make this a reality. How you can democratize AI. We start with the hardware.
Me?
NVIDIA DGX is the instrument of AI.
I think he means business.
Since
owners.
Its launch in 2016,
but he said me.
DGX has been used by companies across industries at the forefront of AI. The
in
reason
Fuji
for
film.
This is that DGX was designed from the ground up as the optimal system for AI. Every component and every interconnect was designed or chosen with great care. And today, DGX incorporates learnings from hundreds of millions of hours of usage on thousands of systems across the planet.
Say hi to everybody.
Oh,
the
hi,
pinnacle
Splat.
Of AI capability is the DGX SuperPod, where multiple DGXs are
what
clustered
think,
together and tuned for AI.
You want to go to
based
Taiwan?
Based on all of NVIDIA's learnings. So the first step to democratization is to make this best-of-breed machine more accessible and more obtainable. To make it more accessible, we are providing a software stack called Base Command Platform. Using Kubernetes, this software allows administrators to share this powerful
full screen
computer
that.
Across an organization of data scientists and a mix of workloads. It provides users with a simple interface for AI, and it allows organizations to understand and optimize their usage of this valuable equipment. We have been using Base Command within NVIDIA for many years, sharing superpods across thousands of data scientists who have run over a million jobs. To make it more obtainable, we are introducing a subscription model for SuperPod. Customers can now experience the capability of a SuperPod or a smaller part of a SuperPod for months at a time. This is a hosted offering in which NVIDIA will manage the infrastructure, reducing the operational burden on customers. The offering includes powerful all-flash storage and integrated data management from NetApp, the pioneer of enterprise NAS storage. NetApp is synonymous with enterprise-grade storage. With
there is something comforting about this guy holding a clicker, even though he's not at a presentation.
He's holding a clicker?
Yeah, he's holding a clicker.
For example,
oh, I didn't realize
Adobe
that's what
is already
it was.
Using
yeah,
the
yeah.
to train style
Which, I mean, he doesn't need to. It's obviously just recording a video, but I don't know. There's something kind of fun about it.
With this offering, we expect that many more customers will be able to experience the unique capability of a SuperPod without the upfront investment. From there, they can graduate to more permanent infrastructure at scale, either their own SuperPod or in the public cloud. Speaking of the cloud, for some time now we have worked with
Matthew
Lang,
probably not. Usually that's
to offer
somebody
powerful
else
GPU instances
that.
In the cloud, leveraging the internal components of DGX.
But maybe
we are proud to announce today that Amazon and Google are working with us to enable base command platform for clusters formed from these cloud instances. This work offers the promise of a true hybrid AI experience for customers. Write once, run anywhere. But even as we democratize access to DGX, the larger objective is to decompose DGX into its smallest AI-optimized parts so that
you
system manufacturers can compose those
yeah,
parts into
yeah.
different form factors for different scenarios, while adding unique value-add capabilities for their customers.
I guess AMD went under and NVIDIA is going over what I expected.
That combines multiple GPUs into a tightly interconnected computing fabric. This is HGX. Then we offered the core GPU from the board as a standalone PCIe card. This is the A100. Now we have further broken down the A100 into smaller form factor GPUs, such as the A30, that draw less power and are lower cost while still providing powerful acceleration. And finally, we have productized the same BlueField 2 DPU that is inside DGX SuperPod, now usable in any server. With this, we have now enabled a complete ecosystem of form factors, from supercomputers to pizza box servers, workstations, and edge devices. These form factors can be used in a variety
server.
Of scenarios.
I want one of those.
From compute, to graphics, to virtual desktops, to data center infrastructure, all made better by AI. HGX boards are the engine of supercomputing. A100 and A30 are optimized for compute. A40 and A10 are best for a mix of compute and graphics. And A16 combines multiple small GPUs into a great form factor for VDI. In order to help system manufacturers create AI-optimized designs and to ensure that the systems can be relied on by customers,
it's a cool name for a server.
NVIDIA Certified
Pizza Box,
a program for servers that incorporate GPU acceleration. NVIDIA Certified provides blueprints for system design as well as test suites so that system manufacturers can validate their designs. Today, we are announcing the expansion of NVIDIA Certified to systems with NVIDIA BlueField DPUs. Going forward, the DPU will be an essential component of every server in the data center and at the edge. This is because, as shown in the diagram, the DPU
and
offloads,
Timothy Baldrin
accelerates,
is,
and secures
is correct.
Functions that must otherwise be performed by the host
CPU. This is interesting stuff to a lot of people.
Last year, we announced BlueField 2, our state-of-the-art DPU. NVIDIA is working
Matthew Lang,
with VMware to use BlueField 2 as the host.
I was just going to say, Matthew Lang, I totally get down on a white pizza.
This year, we released
like
the first version of Docker.
You like the white sauces?
I like the white sauce pizza with chicken.
Will do for the
but, a Hawaiian pizza? I'm not scared to dig into a Hawaiian pizza.
Long-lasting, consistent SDK that they can use from one generation.
Can NVIDIA make a good Hawaiian pizza?
And we are especially pleased to announce that the world's system manufacturers are joining us in the DPU journey by producing state-of-the-art mainstream servers accelerated by NVIDIA BlueField 2. Three of these companies are right here in Taiwan, Asus, Gigabyte, and Quanta.
I would say
BlueField 2 is especially well-suited
to
inspecting the network for security breaches.
Whereas AMD was kind of
the typical approach is to run an agent on the host CPU. This approach consumes host CPU cycles and handles only a narrow window
of
the network traffic.
Our equivalents on the data or enterprise side are like,
allows full inspection.
Heard all this before.
With no host CPU overhead.
I wouldn't know, though.
NVIDIA has created a software platform called Morpheus that uses the BlueField 2 and AI to automatically detect and address security breaches. Today, we are announcing that Red Hat is working with NVIDIA to provide Morpheus developer kits for both OpenShift and Red Hat Enterprise Linux, or RHEL for short. RHEL is the most commonly used version of commercial Linux in enterprise data centers today. Cybersecurity companies will now be able to use Morpheus on RHEL and OpenShift to bring advanced security to every enterprise data center. But this journey is
Can
just
you
beginning.
Your switch?
We are
oh,
already
sorry.
Working
Can you hear
on
that?
BlueField 3.
Oh, wow.
22
oh.
billion
sorry,
transistors.
Sorry, I didn't think it was that loud. Yeah.
The first 400 gigabits per second networking
chip. Steady enough.
16 ARM CPU
I've
cores
two,
to run
two
the entire virtualization
items.
Software.
One of them is a key.
BlueField 3 takes security to a whole new level, fully offloading and accelerating IPsec,
I should do the quiet one.
TLS cryptography, secret key management, and regular expression processing. Whereas BlueField 2 offloaded an equivalent of 30 CPU cores, it would take 300 CPU cores to secure, offload, and
well,
accelerate.
Ruru 2 is talking about in IGN's chat. I'm glad IGN, or glad our chat is, you know, is not spamming. Thank you. We're all just hanging out, you know, talking about pizza.
Same Doka SDK. Today, we are also announcing the expansion
I mean,
of NVIDIA Certified.
I would say that IGN's audience is even one more stop removed on
as the GPU and GPU accelerators take
talk.
On more of the compute yeah. workload for AI, it becomes useful to view the host CPU as an orchestrator more so than as the compute engine. Energy-efficient ARM CPUs are well-suited to this task.
Oh,
and the open licensing model of ARM inspires innovators to create products around it. An exemplar of this approach is NVIDIA's own ARM-based Grace CPU, which will be available in 2023. Grace is purpose-built for accelerated computing applications such as AI that process large amounts of data. 2 years ago, we announced that we were bringing CUDA to ARM, simplifying the development of AI and HPC applications on ARM. Today, along with our partner Taiwan-based Gigabyte, we are happy to announce a dev kit. This dev kit can be used by application developers to prepare their GPU-accelerated apps for ARM.
Ashen
so there
one,
it is,
100%.
Democratizing the hardware for AI with a wide range of accelerators turned into myriad form factors by a broad ecosystem of system builders. 103 different server and workstation form factors from 16 different system builders. More every day. Now let's turn to the software of AI. Every AI workflow can be thought of as a four-step process in a loop. The first step is to take a large amount of unstructured data and prepare it by extracting and organizing its features. The second step is to use the prepared data to train the models. In many cases, the models are then validated or simulated before being used in production or in the physical world. And finally, the actual use of the models, which in turn generates more data that is then fed back to the process. This is the recipe of AI. Over the years, NVIDIA has applied this recipe to create application frameworks for a variety of use cases, including conversational AI, drug discovery, self-driving cars, robotics, virtual collaboration, and recommender systems, the engine of the internet. These frameworks help companies jumpstart their adoption of AI. For example, NVIDIA Cloud
Ashen
is
one,
our application framework for
no.
AI-powered healthcare. It includes SDKs and reference applications
I
for
will.
Drug discovery,
someone
smart hospitals,
to get a
medical imaging, and genomic analysis. One customer that uses Clara is AstraZeneca. With Clara, they created an AI model for generating new drug candidates that target a given disease while maximizing safety. This method has seen recent success with in silico medicine using AI to find a new drug in less than 2 years. Companies across the world are
cool.
using these AI workflows from NVIDIA to improve their businesses and to help their customers.
Yeah, I mean, this is important stuff, even though it's mostly over my head. I mean,
TSMC.
It's important stuff.
We all know TSMC as a giant of the technology ecosystem, producing millions of wafers every year for semiconductor and technology companies across the planet. Analysts have referred to TSMC as the hope diamond of the semiconductor industry. In fact, NVIDIA itself is a very large partner of TSMC, proactively identifying defective materials and classifying them to minimize further defects is a critical aspect of the chip production process. Engineers at TSMC have developed an AI-powered system to automate inspection and defect classification. Their system is 10 times faster and more accurate compared to the previous human method.
I didn't think about that. What computer systems do TSMC use?
Built from the same essential software libraries and toolkits. Now, we have brought all these components together as NVIDIA AI Enterprise,
right.
A coherent, optimized, certified, and supported software platform for AI. NVIDIA AI Enterprise is fully integrated with VMware vSphere, the de facto standard of enterprise computing. It is licensed, priced, and supported in the same way as vSphere for a consistent experience. And it all runs on NVIDIA certified servers. Mainstream volume servers.
John Dokic, yeah.
Are constantly
our NVIDIA AI realized that these Intel GPUs just were all defective. It's just, none of them came off the line.
Useful for more than AI. NVIDIA AI includes RAPIDS, a set of libraries that accelerate machine learning on GPUs. The same libraries can also accelerate the core engines of big data processing.
Yeah, well, same thing could be happening for AMD.
Cloudera is the de facto provider of Apache Spark to enterprise data centers around the world, with over 5 exabytes of data under management. As the technology landscape has changed, Cloudera has developed Cloudera Data Platform, a hybrid data cloud platform that brings customers forward to new technology without having to reinvent their big data pipelines. As we speak, the 2,000 customers of Cloudera are migrating to Cloudera Data Platform. We are pleased to say that NVIDIA and Cloudera have partnered to add transparent GPU acceleration using NVIDIA RAPIDS. A fully integrated solution from Cloudera will be available starting this summer with the release of CDP version 7.17. Customers do not need to understand RAPIDS or change their workflows in any way in order to obtain the benefits of this GPU acceleration. An example of an early customer is the United States Internal Revenue Service. With 0 changes to their fraud detection workflow, they were able to obtain 3 times the performance simply by adding GPUs to their mainstream big data servers. This performance improvement translated to 1/2 the cost of ownership for the same workload. But even as the world is transformed by AI, another shift is underway, amplified by the global pandemic. It is becoming more and more important for virtual teams of people in different locations to collaborate in real time.
I mean, that's true.
This is especially true for 3D workflows, from visualizing architecture, to creating photorealistic content for games and movies, to simulating physically accurate worlds. This is a domain NVIDIA is very familiar with. And the same GPUs and systems we talked about in the democratization of AI are in fact the ideal foundation on which to build a platform for real-time collaboration and simulation of 3D designs. This is NVIDIA Omniverse. Omniverse makes it easy for teams to collaboratively design and simulate in 3D. We built Omniverse with open standards based on Pixar's USD, a powerful file framework and scene description language. With open standards, Omniverse enables teams to connect and work across multiple design applications or asset.
You know, in the past, I have looked into real-time cloud-based video editing
just as we did with
options. I remember at NAB, 2 or 3 years ago, there was this. It used Premiere Pro, but it was cloud-based.
Omniverse Enterprise can run on any NVIDIA RTX powered infrastructure.
Yeah, it was all running on AWS stuff. I don't remember. Actually, you know what? I think it was in the Amazon AWS like section of NAB.
We are excited.
It was just like a little offshoot, but yeah. I mean,
for
me, it's more like, oh, it'd be fun to link into a project that Willis is working on and kind of, you know, make a tweak or something like that. But yeah, I mean,
it's still for the world's most important third-party design application.
It's still ways off. There's no way.
Designers and creators to use
their preferred tools. 5 years, 10 years,
while simultaneously editing a scene together. Companies around the world.
I mean, the problem is always going to be the footage. Where does the footage lie?
To collaborate in amazing ways.
Where does that live?
Yeah, where does that live? If it all lives in the cloud, that's different. But also, you know, it's like one of our projects could be up to 1/4 of a terabyte. So we'd have to upload all that. work off of all that, then that's not cheap either. Yeah, you gotta have a good connection. Yeah.
So that sounds like, once again, the U.S. Broadband infrastructure is going to be the limiting factor.
Well, but also latency, too. I mean, gaming's one thing, working on stuff. Like, if I get a frame drop, I don't know if it's a frame drop that's in the video, or I don't know if that's in... Yeah, well, you know, like, it's just like, wait, crap. Yeah, so it's different. Oh man, there's people setting off fireworks outside.
Where are you from, Misty?
I'm from a place called Omniverse.
It's America.
Yeah.
That voice is more disturbing than the face.
I know, right?
You know, having grown up in the U.S., I had no idea how, you know, restrictive or not restrictive other countries are about fireworks.
So, there
and
you have.
I guess in Germany, they're highly restricted. You only get to, like, use like, certain
every
kinds
company.
On New Year's Eve.
This is a giant opportunity and responsibility for all of us. What we've talked about today
That's
are three
than,
essential
you know,
ingredients built by NVIDIA.
Set itself partial fire.
The hardware foundation from which to build any system. The
Sounds
software
like
platform
up.
For artificial intelligence. The software platform for collaborative design. Together, we can use these three ingredients to transform every company.
I think if you understand.
Yet, this is the same hardware and software
boring,
technology
right?
that is at the heart of GeForce. The gaming GPU,
you know,
which is where
your,
it all began.
Your knowledge,
I'll close with a simple thank you. On behalf of my co-presenter, Jeff Fisher, our CEO, Jensen Huang, and all of NVIDIA, thank you. Thank you for joining us today.
Okay.
Thank you for being with us every step of the way. And thank you
for
continuing
you.
Forward with us on this amazing journey.
I mean, thank you to our audience for sticking with us through this as we wait for the wrap-up session.
I know, right. Okay, I guess I'm going to switch over because that... I think that was it.
I think so.
Yep.
We're done.
No, we're not going to watch. I'm just going to pause it on a... Okay. Yeah. Well, then, you heard it here first. More people playing games than ever. Oh, crap. Sorry. I'm also at the same time trying to find the footage of where the 3080 Ti announcement is. There it is.
Begin on June 3rd, I have the specs starting at 11 for comparison up to.
Oh, okay.
We need to do that.
There we go. Yeah. Well, the second part, GeForce laptops are the fastest selling platform. I thought that's kind of interesting. I mean, we knew laptops are a big seller, but when you're talking about platform, you're comparing it to consoles, you're comparing it to other gaming devices. I'm curious to see what they mean by platform. But, I mean, a lot of people bought new laptops, right?
Are they counting miners purchasing laptops in there? No, I'm serious. It's not just a troll question. Because, I mean, there were a lot of purchases after a while when people couldn't get their hands on discrete GPUs or desktop GPUs.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I do wonder if they're not really being used for gaming. They're just being used for mining. Like, if they have other metrics that they're counting, like GeForce... experience, installations, and all that kind of stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think it's more they sold them. They GeForce laptops are the fastest selling platform. Didn't say who to who, but yeah. The bigger announcement, 3080 Ti, $1,200 June 2nd. I have the still frame from the announcement up. Elena, what do you think? $1,200.
I mean, honestly, if you could, like, okay, let's just say all things are equal and you can get this for list price, but you can't get previous cards for list price, you may as well get this, right? Because at least you're getting more for that amount of money you're spending. But I think at this point, everyone's kind of has graphics card fatigue. In the sense of, like, they're just tired of being told about cards and then getting excited for it and then not being able to do anything with that excitement because they can't get their hands on the card. So I almost wonder if in some ways that'll make it easier for people who still give it a good go, or if it just means it's all just going to be terrible as it has been.
I don't know. I mean, it definitely slots in. This is not a refresh. This is slotting in between that 3080 and 3090, like we've talked about where it would be. I think 1200 is more than I thought it'd be. I thought it'd probably hit more towards 1000, but yeah, whatever. 12 gigabytes of memory. It's still a step down from the 3090, though. Some people are saying, you know, just go ahead and buy a 3090, but that's definitely a whole different beast as well.
You save $300 compared to a 3090 in theory, so...
Yeah.
I would say, though, that the amount of difference between the 3080 Ti and a 3080 in price is kind of startling when you compare the 3070 Ti and put that up against the 3070, the standard right. 3070.
Yeah, which, so 600 and a standard 3070 is what, 570?
Is that so, MSRP, I looked it say? Up. So the 3070s, in theory, its MSRP is $500, and it's 8 gigabytes of just standard GDDR6 memory.
Okay.
3070 Ti will also have 8 gigabytes of memory, but it get a little bit of upgrade in that it's GDDR6X, and it costs $600 list price.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. It's also interesting that they were throwing in the 1080 Ti in there when referencing the 3080 Ti.
I saw that. I was like, Gordon's gonna have more ammunition.
We can finally retire all those 1080 Ti jokes, right? You know, now you don't need your 1080 Ti. You have a 3080 Ti. but that's definitely a big jump. Yeah. So there's the 3070 at 500, the 3070 Ti at 600. The 3080 at, what is it, 800?
In theory, it's supposed to be 700.
Is it supposed to be 700? Wow, okay. Mm-hmm. Then, yeah, oh, crap, for some reason I thought it was 800. Then, the jump between the 3080 and the 3080 Ti, that's $500?
It's big.
Wow, that's a big jump. Okay, yeah, crazy.
Yep.
Yeah.
Honestly, I think for most people... the 3070 Ti is probably going to be a little more attractive if you don't need the larger, you know, buffer, the larger memory. That one becomes available later. So 3080 Ti was June 3rd, was it? Next Thursday? This Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
This Thursday.
Yep.
And then 3070 Ti is supposed to launch on June 10th, which would be the following Thursday.
Yeah. Also interesting, they didn't talk about hash rate limiters. I mean, maybe this isn't the audience, or maybe you don't really put that in a keynote. But yeah, I mean, they didn't talk about mining. They didn't talk about scalping. They didn't talk about, stock, which I didn't think they would. Yeah. But like at the same time, the not mentioning, I mean, I'm sure it has it, but not trying to lean into it and be like, hey, by the way, we're working hard to, you know, combat this stuff. We have hash rate limiters for miners who want the mining card. We've got mining cards.
I did think this presentation was a little interesting. And I know, you know, was AMD caught some flack from, you know, gamers about its CES 2021 keynote. Mm-hmm. They're like, oh, this is so boring. Like, why are you just going through the laundry list of partners? But it's because the audience wasn't us, right? It was like they needed to talk to like shareholders and other people and analysts to kind of get them on board with the story they wanted to tell. But here I couldn't tell who the audience was for this story that NVIDIA was trying to tell. Like I didn't know who they were trying to convince to be on board with them. Because it felt like the kind of presentation you would pitch to other executives, right? It's a little high level. It's a recap of all the great things you're doing with the company, who you're targeting for your for sales. But if it was meant to get gamers excited, I don't think it did that personally.
Yeah, you know, when we were talking about this earlier, there's obviously more announcements from a lot of these companies when it comes to E3. So I wonder if maybe they have an E3 thing as well that's going to be a little different. This felt very interesting for sure. I mean, once again, it's Computex. It's definitely more of a different market than like an E3. Somebody said it's that this felt more like a GTC presentation. I don't think it was like that. I mean, maybe the second half a little bit, but not that first half. They was still trying to be consumer focused there, but yeah, like just recapping, like, hey, we're doing all great stuff, cool. Here's a couple parts, cool. And then let's talk about data center stuff, which is interesting in its own right too. I almost feel like it could have been two presentations, but you know, I understand why they did it in one.
Yeah.
But yeah, so maybe there's a different kind of stuff coming for E3. Who knows? I mean, and new parts. Maybe they also knew that, and we have a lot of sentiment in the chat here that, and new parts, I can't get stock anyway, so who cares? You know, so maybe they didn't. They wanted to talk to the higher, you know, higher level of business buyers.
So then in that case, are they just speaking to people who would those people be though? Because there's so much focus on gamers, right? It's not like they're targeting people who develop games so that they would want to talk about games, but have them put these in their machines for whatever, you know, rendering and creative stuff that they were talking about, because that wasn't the focus. They kept talking about, like, look at this ray tracing and this DLSS support we're bringing to these games. Mm-hmm. And then they said, like, look at these two new, like, flagship versions of previous cards we've been doing. Mm-hmm. Or I guess I should say one true new flagship card and an upgraded version of the 3070. But again, like, it didn't feel like it actually spoke to the audience. Like, it was almost like they were afraid to really talk about the real world issues that, you know, is going on. But I think that's kind of a shame, because I think AMD did this better in that they hinted at what's going on in the world and the problems, right? Where they're basically saying, well, look, we know it's hard to get a discrete GPU. So that's why we're announcing that we're going to bring these things to the front, right? We're going to give you APUs that can game on their own because you can't get a discrete GPU. We're going to give you, you know, FSR finally because you can't get a new GPU, right? Mm-hmm. We're going to make it operable on our competitor's card because you can't get a new GPU. So there's a way of doing it, right? I just don't think NVIDIA captured that same spirit that AMD did.
Yeah, this felt like it could have existed in a pre-COVID time as well, right? Not really addressing too much of where the current state is. Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, and does it need to be? I mean, they're still selling, I guess. That's the other point. They could be like, hey, whatever, we're in the lead. We're doing great things. We're blazing the trail on DLSS and RTX, and we got data center. We're looking to buy ARM. Everything's, you know, hunky-dory. So it's, to a certain degree,
I don't know, I still felt like it lacked a certain excitement I would expect from being on top. You know, if you know, that was their message. Like, we're on top. It's like, don't you want to take a victory lap then? Like, wouldn't you? I don't know. I'd be kind of excited about still being number one.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. It's interesting. I think, well, we said this at the end of the AMD one, where there's more info to come out from Computex, so we're going to have a full nerd by the end of the week to kind of cover all this stuff. So I'll definitely be interested to hear Brad's take on this, you know, how it lines up. But also at the same time, I mean, once it launches, or at least one is this week, another one is next week, you know, I doubt we're going to be able to see these at MSRP. Just because they introduced new SKUs does not necessarily mean that they're making more cards. The supply is still going to be what the supply is. This doesn't solve anything on that end. It just introduces more options.
I would say from Vid in the chat saying, you know, if they had said that the AI ability in the cards would improve on graphics graphics performance without the need to change anything in development or drivers, it would be one thing, right? Like, that'd be exciting. But, you know, he wasn't impressed by the presentation. And I actually expected kind of the same, where, you know, they're in the press release about the keynote, they kind of sort of tease this AI angle. So I thought that that was going to be their kind of riding in to save the gamers from the evil, you know, scalper situation. Well, it's like, we can't just magically conjure more silicon, but we can do these like software things and in the cloud and whatnot to kind of help you all out to get more performance out of what you've got in hand.
Yeah. Speaking of cloud, no GeForce Now. A small mention of cloud.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that's maybe what they're trying to get at with the whole DLSS, so broader DLSS support and, you know, RTX or ray tracing support coming to, you know, more games.
They showed a lot of games.
I just don't feel like it didn't have that, like, we are coming to save you from the evil, right? It just was like, here are some games that we've added stuff to. It's going to be cool. And it felt kind of like almost a foreshadowing of what we're supposed to expect at E3, as opposed to addressing things from like a tech industry angle.
Yeah. Very, very, very curious indeed. Ashen One, I'm not quite sure when those go on sale. You'd have to ask somebody else. But yeah, we'll see. I think it's usually what, 6 a.m. Pacific time is when NVIDIA cards usually go on sale, or Founders Edition, I should say.
It has been that it's like 6 a.m. Pacific. I don't know why they do that to everybody in Pacific and Hawaiian time, but it is what it is. I'm sure Brad will have more details for you, I think in the morning, because he's asleep right now. Mm-hmm. So you can stop by PCWorld.com in the morning, and we'll have that info for you all.
Yeah, confirmed SK, you can also mine on a 3090. Yeah, once again, they didn't talk about the hash rate limiter stuff. I think that's another curious, like, if they would have mentioned that, that's also a nod to be like, hey, we know what's going on. A lot of miners are getting these cards. So, yeah.
I'm actually curious what chat thinks, because I just saw, you know, the comment here from Zanza about hard pass on this generation. You know, has this kind of persistent misery around trying to get a current generation graphics card, and then, you know, it's slowly seeping out into previous generations? Like, are you just going to wait until like 2022 at this point? Are you just going to make do with what you have? Because I have a friend who is helping another friend build a PC, and I think that poor person spent something like $300 for what was normally a $150 budget card. Which was like, ooh, sorry.
Yeah, that's a bummer. I mean, it is a bummer. Like, sure, MSRP prices have gone up, but also performance. I mean, these 30 series GPUs are pretty good. it's a nice jump, even though there's the price jump. But also, yeah, it's like, but everything else around it is just like,
you can't get it. Like, it's the kind of, not, you know, a non-starter at that point.
Yeah. So anyway, so we,
I do see one person saying that they're waiting for an Intel GPU now.
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess we'll see if they can have supply as well. They have supplies on CPUs just fine, so maybe they can figure out GPUs.
CPUs is still a little constrained right now too.
I know, right? Yeah,
it's still really hard to get 5900 or 5950X.
Yeah. Okay. I think we wrap it up.
Yeah, it's sleepy time for us.
Yeah. Thanks everybody for hanging out. That was fun. We watched two major press conferences. There are articles on a lot of this stuff up on PC World, so go check that out. There are other announcements that will be happening through the week. I'll do our best to post that stuff in our Discord. We have like an article announcement thing in there, even if it's not video related. And yeah, we'll definitely have a full nerd later to kind of deconstruct this stuff, because I'm pretty curious about it as well. And then we'll see what happens with these new GPU launches. I think it's just going to come and go at this point.
Thank you all
for
hanging out with us, especially because I know for some of you it's like weird time It's either like super late at night or like crack of dawn early for you.
I know, right? And it's late here, past 11, past my bedtime.
I know, I'm sleepy too. The cat already went to sleep somewhere in this area.
Lucky. BB's, I'm sure, just waiting for dinner. So, anyway, yeah. So, yeah, thanks everybody. Stay tuned for more information. Give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed hanging out with us, and be sure to subscribe for more coverage. Until then, everybody have a good day, have a good night, have a good morning, wherever you're at. Have a good week. I'm gonna go to sleep now. Thanks, Elena, for hanging out as well this late, and thanks Splat and BB for being our overlords. Anyway, we'll talk to everyone later. Bye.